Beth here from Crowley House Flower Farm. I thought today I would just tell you a little story about how I got started doing what I do and actually kind of what I do. A lot of people ask that question kind of, well, how did you end up here? So probably, what, 25 years ago? I started as in the medical field working. I worked in the medical field for about 18 years. And then I kind of dropped down part-time. I was working only 4 days a week generally. And then I went down to 3 days a week. And then I went down to 1 day a week. And then I went down to just filling in now and then. So I became, well, I've always grown flowers my whole life. I come from a family of 12, and I have 8 sisters, and I'm the third oldest in the family, and there's 3 brothers. So we grew up on a farm, and we grew flowers and kind of designed. My oldest sister went, and she actually worked for a floral designer and that kind of thing. So it just kind of came naturally that we would grow flowers and we would use them in events and in design work. And we mainly just did weddings for friends and that kind of thing. I think I was probably 13 when I first started. So it was kind of one of those things that I would just dabble in for fun every once in a while, even at my farm, or not my farm. We lived in like a city and a neighborhood, and there was kids, and I had young kids, and I was mainly a mom, you know, just did the mom thing, worked, did the whole, you know, I don't know, soccer and, you know, baseball, that kind of thing. And then I ended up one day, a friend of mine said, "Hey, can you do my wedding?" And I was like, "Sure." A little nervous. And I ended up doing it. So it was kind of interesting. I remember thinking, "Oh, wow, I really enjoy this." And then another friend saw my work that I did for the wedding. And she's like, "Can you do some flowers for me in my downtown display window in our little town?" And then the restaurant next door is like, "Oh my gosh, we haven't seen flowers like this since we were down in Napa Valley. We would love it if you do our restaurant flowers." And then the next restaurant asked, that kind of thing. It just snowballed. So before I knew it, we ended up selling our house. We moved in with my parents looking for a farm. One day I found this farm and told my husband, "Hey, we're moving to the country." And part of it was I wanted our kids to go to the school that's out here. It's a K-12 little tiny school, and I wanted them to go there. So that was our main motivation for moving out to this area. So long story, I ended up still working full time. I had all this property. I had no idea people actually grew flowers for a living. So I started planting things, and I miserably failed my very first year. I literally failed horribly, and I thought, what am I thinking? So I think I should get some books on growing flowers. So I went to Barnes & Noble one day and got some books. I found Deborah Prenzing's Slow Flower book, 50 Mile Bouquet, and I read that, and I just was like, oh my God. People do this for a living? What? So super exciting. Anyways, I was going to take you guys, but I'm planting here. I'll show you. So today I went down to our little local hardware store and bought a few little pops to go on our front porch because it is January. I need some gloves here. January, and I don't know about you, but just having a little welcome color spot on the front porch just does the soul good. Okay, so back to my story. I found that magical book that told me there was other crazy people out there growing and selling flowers. And then at that time, I was like, maybe I can make some money at this. I don't know. We'll see. Kind of like this blue one. So there's a story behind these. These are primroses. Little primroses, you know, you can get at the little market. My dad, oh, they smell. They smell so, so good. But my dad would take us girls, their little sundresses. Well, not at that time. They were like sundresses and coats. And we'd go down, and my dad would let us pick out a primrose for our front porch. So I've kept that tradition ever since. And my color that I always picked was blue. Blue is my favorite color. Anyways, so I basically was really excited that there was other crazy people doing this. And I thought, well, maybe I'm not so crazy after all. I'm just semi-normal. So I thought, well, I'll just do it, you know, part-time for fun. I'll do some weddings. I'll just, you know, grow some vegetables and food for the family and be able to, you know, kind of help out a little bit more with building this farm. And so my original idea was that any money that I made on the farm would just go directly back into the farm, growing flowers, that kind of thing. Well, one thing led to another, because this has been over 8 years ago. So I started growing probably 10 years ago, and then we've been here for almost 9 years, I think. So I started growing, and people just loved it and supported me, and I had wedding after wedding after wedding. And then all of a sudden I met somebody up in Seattle that invited me to be a part of the Seattle Wholesale Growers Market, which is a wholesale company, because I was growing all these flowers for weddings, and I didn't know what to do with the extra stuff. So I joined up there, and that was when they were really small. And it was great to be around some other farmers that actually knew stuff. I just kind of like, oh, this is pretty, so I'll plant it, and then I'll research how to grow it. And I did, and then all of a sudden the whole the Florette thing came about, and she kind of made things really popular and a lot of great information and classes and that kind of thing. And then there was a few other people doing stuff, and it just, flower farming became alive about that point with tons. I think the first like growers meeting that I went to, there was 25 farmers, and most of them had been doing it, well, their parents or their grandparents had been doing it prior, or they had been doing it for, you know, 20 years or 10 years or whatever. And I was just like this newbie going, hey, let's have a potluck and get together and figure out. I just wanted to meet some people that were doing this. So here in Oregon, there was about 25. So I grow in zone 8B in the Willamette Valley in a little town called Rickreall. It's really not a town. It's a, there is a post office and a little store and a Kubota dealership, which is really convenient. But our little community out here is called Oak Grove. It's beautiful. We live down a dirt road. It's about 2 miles each way to get out and in from the main road. And then there's just this beautiful little church and an old historic grange and a schoolhouse, which I would love to buy the schoolhouse someday if it ever came for sale, but I highly doubt I'll be able to do that. I have dreams. It's just the cutest little thing. Anyways, so I ended up growing flowers for Seattle, learning how to grow flowers well. That's my big thing. Drying flowers. So many mentors, so many great folks that have been doing this for a long, long time kind of came alongside me and kind of showed me what to do. So that was kind of, ended up being kind of the backbone of what we do is selling to Seattle Wholesale Growers Market. Since then, our wedding and event design business has taken off big time. Like, I have two girls that work with me full time. One is my daughter, Riley, which you've seen in some of the videos. She works with me full time on the farm. And I have her cousin, actually, Emma, that works full time with me. And then I do have a gal that comes and works part time with me two to 4 days a week. She works with me in the farm gardens. I do a lot of that part still, and I do enjoy designing, and I always help with every single wedding that we do. But I've trained both the girls really, really well on basically how to design and the look and feel. And Riley naturally has it because she's my child. And Emma, too, she's related. So they naturally kind of have my style, which is kind of fun to see. Okay, on to the next. I'm thinking to do... Okay, let's go. So in this next little pot, I think I'm kind of loving this like orangey color, and maybe this guy's kind of fun. This is a little viola. I don't know how to say that. I like this little yellow color too. It's kind of fun. What do you think of that? It's kind of cool. This is, it looks like it's maybe a double primrose. It's got a whole bunch of new babies coming, so that's why I got that one. These smell so, so sweet, and that's why I like to put them next to the front door. It doesn't really say what it is, but, oh, just, yes, that's yummy. I love that. Okay, I think that's the combination I'm going to go with. So both the girls design with me. This is the first year that both of them are working pretty much full-time designing. We've got weddings booked every single weekend through the summer. And I'm looking forward to that, but I'm also, what I'm looking forward to is just having somebody that will be there so that I can actually take a break. Because for the first, well, this is my first year, this last year, 2020 is my first year of basically being able to breathe for a few minutes between events because I have had my help on the farm. Before that, I have to say the first probably 8 years of farming, I worked my butt off. I hardly ever slept. By the time winter came along, I was just, my body hurt. I hated farming. I didn't want to do it. But I had quit my job. So I've been doing farming full time for 3 years, basically. So that's kind of cool. So I had to replace my income in the medical field to be able to get there. That's what my husband said. You had to make this much money per week in order to be able to farm full time. So I just had that goal written down, what I had to make every single day to make up that deal. So it took me a couple years of just working my butt off to try and make the numbers work for me to stay full time. I remember during that time, my son got really, really sick and we were in and out of the hospital. And I just thought, I am determined to be a mom that can stay home with him and just be able to be free to do that. And so thankfully I was only working like one day a week and my husband could stay home with him. But it was just, you know, my son just wanted, you know, at that point, he was in, let's see, I think sixth grade is when he started really getting sick. Seventh grade, really, really sick. And then it just kind of moved on from there. But I remember just thinking, like, I want to be a mom that can just be with him and be able to be there and not miss that kind of stuff. And he was the type of kid that just wanted his mom there. I mean, he'd ask for dad every once in a while, but there's something about a mama's love that when a kid's so sick that they're in the hospital, that kind of thing, they definitely, there's a mama role there that needs to be filled. Woo! So anyways, so we kind of went through that. And at that point, I was like, okay, I'm making enough money. I think I can leave. So I did. I stepped away probably a year into that whole ordeal. I remember the doctor I was working for at that time, he was just super great about just go, Beth, if you need to go, and I'd have to just leave and go pick him up, or, you know, whatever it is that I was doing with him. And just, they were very flexible with just letting me be home with him if I needed to. But during that year, I remember he was on some steroids at the time, and if you know anything about steroids, they can affect people really, really badly. And it was to the point that, you know, here he is, a little kid, and he would throw these huge tantrums, what have you. Oh my gosh, it was awful. Thankfully, that only lasted for about 2 weeks, but I remember cracking his window, and it was close enough to the greenhouse where I would run out and I'd water my seedlings, and then I would, you know, check a few things and run back and listen. I should have gotten one of those little baby monitors now that I think about it, but I didn't. So anyways, that was a long story. So I was determined at that point that I was going to be a stay-at-home mom. So I ended up quitting. I was able to take care of him. It took us probably 3 years to get him kind of to the stable point that he's at now. We're super thankful. He has Crohn's disease, and a blood disorder on top of it. And so it was just a long road. So that's what drove me to do this full-time living. I had a motivation, and I stuck with it. I worked my ass off, and I still work my ass off, but now I have help. Because that was one thing I learned. I can't do this on my own. It's not a one-person show. So fast forward a couple years to today. Now I am just farming full-time. We mainly do probably, I would say, about 70 to 75% of our business is event design and weddings. And I thought that would curve off during COVID time, but it hasn't. I am so thankful for that, because that was one thing that I thought, oh God, I'm going to tank big time. But I we opened up our studio, which we hadn't done that before. So that kind of replaced some of the income last year. And we just had flowers for people to come by and pick up. We were open 2 days a week. I pushed our wholesale, and I ended up doing a lot of a lot of market bouquets. So, and that worked really well for us this year, and kind of filled some of the gaps that we had with the event and wedding design. But still, all of our weddings that we did, they didn't adjust their budgets at all, which was really great. We had a few that kind of bumped off to this year. So this year, it's January, and I pretty much have space for maybe 3 weddings going forward. Maybe more. Big weddings I'm talking about, not the little bucket sales. I can do those all day long. So, and we've got a lot of vineyards around here, so I'm able to just, you know, work with the vineyards around. We do, like, if they have like a wine club member or something like that, where they do their memberships, a lot of times we're doing these little like farmer gift basket things with their wine, and then they get this bouquet of flowers, and then there's other farms that pitch in with different items, which is really, really fun. I love seeing that kind of stuff. That's new this year. And then we've got like a Valentine's Day coming up. Riley's actually gonna be designing that. She's got a whole beautiful design for a Valentine's Day event. It's not very big, it's small, but somebody really wanted to do this, and I'm excited to see that. She's kind of put together this whole, like, it's almost like a cloud kind of design that she's doing. So that'll be kind of fun. That will be coming up on probably not next video, but the video after that. So she'll be doing that along with Emma. They work like two peas in a pod. I just help a little bit with the design part of aspects and jimmy rigging things. So there's always that engineering of things, you know. A lot of times the buildings that we're doing, they've got high ceilings. They've got, you know, you can't tack anything to the walls. You can't, you know, you have to be really like have extension cords and kind of think, okay, something can't crash on somebody. So over the years, I've learned all the tricks and little bits that they're still learning now. I'm going to take you with me to the front porch, and I'm going to plant the rest of these cute little flower pops that we have, like little color spots for the front porch. It's been a little bit windy today, so that's why I kind of hesitated coming outside, but I'll take it anyways. It'll be fun. Plant together.
So I think with flower farming, you know, you have to have lots of multiple avenues of, you know, things that you do to kind of figure out what works best for you and your family. And I think setting those goals of where you kind of want yourself or what dollar amount you think you need to be at in order to, you know, if you want to be someone that this is their full-time job or, oh, I see my hostas are growing. They're coming along. I just had one right there. I think a little pop of yellow would be kind of fun. You know, slugs love these. So you have to, if you have some in the ground, you have to put a little slug bait down. I'd like to use a little slug O. Anyways, isn't that pretty? I think that's like a, maybe the, yeah, I think this is the double one. I've got some really pretty tulips in here and some daffodils. And then there's hostas, and a lot of times I just put these little color spots in, but just makes for kind of fun little welcome at the front door. So going forward, what am I saying? Going forward. So yeah, you just kind of have to find what works best for you and what your goals are. A lot of people like to do this kind of thing just for fun, just as a little hobby. You know, they find the joy of bringing flowers to somebody down the road, or, you know, giving away some flowers, that kind of thing. And I didn't have that luxury just to do that. I had to make some money at what I did. So there were times where I had to get super creative with how we sold our flowers, and that's where I've come up with all the things that we do, the wholesale, the weddings and event design. We do here on the farm occasionally. We didn't do it so much this last year, but we host some dinners and that kind of thing on the farm. So these are just basically events that you would, somebody had a birthday party, and so we did a small dinner and we had some great wine and we had birthday cake and a little fireplace, and it was a very, very small group. There's a plane. So going forward on our farm this year, we'll probably continue to have some of the kind of events on the farm as far as classes and that kind of thing. I enjoy that. Having weddings on the weekends, you know, it's hard to, especially if it's a big wedding, it's hard to be able to do both. So I'm trying to, with the girls, I think, helping out this year, I'll be able to pull some of those off myself with my husband and son are able to help a little bit. So that'll be kind of good. And I think people really, really need that. I think that they need a little bit of something to kind of give them something to look forward to. And because our farm is outdoors and we are able to host, I think it would be a good thing. So I have to get those up on my website as far as having availability. So we do the events and classes here on the farm. This last year we didn't hardly do any. We just kind of did a few private events for folks that we knew and that kind of thing. So we still did a lot of weddings. This year we'll still do a lot of weddings. We're gonna have a lot of weddings. We'll still be doing the wholesale, and we also sell to 2-3 wholesalers right now. So I have the one in Portland, one in Seattle,
And then we sell occasionally to Mayesh. So that's kind of how I make my money. And then the majority of it comes from events and design work. But anyways, it's kind of what I do in a nutshell here on the farm. So this is what I did really fast. I'll show you while I was talking to you, our front porch. Beautiful Gothic farmhouse. So I just did these little color spots because they're cute. My little pots. Oh, I'll need something for up there. Well, I appreciate you hanging out with me today and listening to my how I got started farming story. The pure accident that ended up a hobby turned into a full-time job, and now I have employees, and I feel very, very proud about that because that doesn't happen very often. And usually a small business doesn't even make it to 5 years. I remember there was this guy who came to one of our events, and he was an elderly gentleman, and he came up to me and he asked, because I had told my story a little bit about, like, well, how I got started farming, and I just kind of did it because I thought it would be fun and I thought it would be a great job and no one else was doing it. And he goes, you know, Beth, you should be really, really proud of yourself because being a woman, having a job that actually is successful and farming at that, you just don't see that in the corporate world or anywhere world around as far as a small business goes. And so I remember thinking, and at that moment it kind of hit me like, oh, I have done good, you know, because sometimes I think you see so many failures. You don't always, at least I don't always acknowledge the accomplishments, and it is true. I have made it past the 5 year mark, and I actually have money at the end of the year now, which is nice, and I'm able to support my family. I'm able to be a mom and be a homemaker. Not that I wasn't before, but I'm able to do both my passions as my full-time job. So that's cool. Part of the new thing for me on this farm is I used to just, well, the very first year I farmed, I had vegetables, huge vegetable garden, and flowers. And then I went to all flowers, and I did that for 4 or 5 years, just all flowers. Last 2 years, we've been putting in vegetable gardens again. And then this year, the vegetable gardens are going to get expanded back to what they originally were when we first started. Crazy, I know. So my plan is, just because I do have the 2 girls in help this year, is that I'm going to be able to do a little bit more as far as preserving our food, saving our food. And I think that became really important when my son got so sick, and we definitely had to change and think about what we were eating. Before, it was just kind of like whatever kind of thing. But now he's very limited on what he can and can't eat, even though he does venture into the stuff he's not supposed to eat, like a teenager would. And he's learning, doing better, but it all helps us to really think about where our food comes from and what we're eating, what we're putting into our bodies. And so that's why it's so important that we do that this year, especially. I actually have my son helping, Brayden, such a sweetheart. He just did a little report for school on vegetables and raising your own food, meat, eggs, chickens, that kind of thing. And I got to help him with it, and it was super fun. And you could see the little light bulbs going off, and he knew a lot. He already knew a lot more than I thought he would. So that was kind of fun to do that little project with him. So I'm hoping that this year he'll help me a little bit more in the garden. And we've talked about it. We've pulled the seeds and everything that we're growing. I think next vlog I'll probably go through some of the things that we're growing here on the farm this year. People have been asking for that on my Instagram, so I thought I would share that here as well. So anyways, well, I hope you enjoyed this video, and I appreciate you just hanging around to listen to my story. listen to how I got started in this crazy world of flower farming, and I am looking forward to having you back again, giving you some garden tours, and even having you hang around with us when we do an event or two. So that'll be kind of fun. Anyways, thanks again. See you later. Bye.